The Overwatch League has been making huge moves to establish itself as a dominant force in the esports industry, with everything from selling out the Barclays Center in New York to adding 8 new teams to its now 20-team roster. Now, I know we get a lot of Overwatch just from the league alone, but here are a few reasons why 2019 is the year for Overwatch contenders and why you should be tuning in to their new LAN events.
The instant EMP is going to come through. 5 people are going to get hacked. Byung-Pung isn't towards the nano at all, so he can't save Kaiser. Proper's going to go down as well. Pentagon's going to fall. Enemy Mystic rushing O2 Blast onto the point. The nano boost.
The obvious topic that I won't spend too much time on is that players and whole teams are being drafted from Overwatch contenders into the Overwatch League. The Vancouver Titans are one of the best examples of drafting done right, as the undefeated team is actually composed of the Overwatch Contenders Korea team, Team Runaway. Now, the team has 2 Contenders Championships under their belt, and they've been performing like a well-oiled machine for the past year or so, and they continued that reign of terror into the Overwatch League. Dako and Pokpo from the Atlanta Reign were former Overwatch Contenders Korea players, Nene and Flower from the NYXL played in Overwatch Contenders North America, and the list goes on and on and on. So even if you only tune into the playoffs of Overwatch Contenders, you'll still get a taste of who could come into the league as the new Bumper or the new Jake. But to the general audience, scouting doesn't really matter. A lot of people don't care about who the next big up-and-comers are and things like that. So why should you watch Contenders if you really don't care about who's gonna be the next up-and-coming star? Well, previously the best Contenders teams from each region were only able to compete against each other, making competition fairly limited. EU went up against EU, Korea went up against Korea, and NA went up against NA. Overwatch Contenders also ran during the Overwatch League season, making it difficult to find time or energy to watch it all. Now don't get me wrong, I'm okay with staying up till 4 a.m. to watch some good old-fashioned Korea Overwatch playoffs, but most people in the general populace don't want to do that. Well, there's a fix for that. This year, Blizzard announced a series of showdown events meant to give Contenders players a chance to compete in large LAN events. The Pacific Showdown from 2 weeks ago pitted Australia, China, Korea, and Pacific teams against each other, while the Atlantic Showdown made European, North American, South American, and a bunch of other teams fight for dominance. Now, each region only had a certain amount of slots, and what happened is you saw these battles emerge where people weren't just fighting for themselves to move on to the Gauntlet, which is kind of like their Final Four event, but people were fighting for their whole region. Now, not only did these teams play each other for the first time in a competitive LAN event, but the best teams from both the Atlantic and the Pacific Showdown also received invites to test their skills at the Gauntlet, and this is where they really battle it out for supremacy. The Pacific Showdown was an intense and almost featured an absolutely insane comeback from O2 Blast, but unfortunately Element Mystic is an unstoppable force. Now, there was nothing really surprising about the Pacific Showdown. If you watch any Contenders, you kind of know how it's gonna go. But the cool thing is that with the Pacific, we saw a lot of the 2-2-2 meta emerge, and this was a nice and refreshing take, seeing, you know, high-level Overwatch, but not GOATs. It was nice, I will admit. Now, the Atlantic Showdown began with many of the EU teams being compared to Clockwork Vendetta, who is an EU Contenders Trials champion that has been dominating the scene ever since April. And we are starting to see some really cool storylines emerge within the EU and just the contender scene in general. Now, a lot of people questioned whether or not Angry Titans and British Hurricane should even be in the series considering how well Clockwork Vendetta is doing, but unfortunately, Clockwork Vendetta didn't make it into Contenders in time to compete for this event. But aside from that, let's stop talking about Clockwork Vendetta for a second. British Hurricane and Angry Titans both got sent to the loser's bracket in the first round. Angry Titans almost had the chance to keep the EU dream alive, but Team Envy had some other plans. Now, the showdown ended with a much-expected Fusion University win over Team Envy, but hopefully they can get their revenge at the Gauntlet. Now, while I think that they will perform well, I have a feeling that this whole Atlantic team versus Pacific teams will end up something like this.
Enough! You are all of you beneath me! I am a god, you dull creature, and I will not be bullied by...
god.
Now, the best part about these contender LAN events is that they happen within the breaks of Overwatch League versus the playoffs that take place during the Overwatch League season. This is what I was talking about, where it's hard to find time, and now that we had a 2-week break from Overwatch stage, and you know, we saw the All-Stars event, this is a great way for people who don't have any Overwatch League to tune into and who aren't really into the streamer scene. This was a great way for them to see competitive play at a high level, but with interesting compositions. The Clockwork Vendetta was brought out, 222 was brought out, and we saw just a lot of cool, goofy things from the lower bracket teams and from the upper bracket teams. They kind of flex their muscles and show that not only are they able to perform well, but they can do it in a flashy manner. The Atlantic and the Pacific Showdown had incredible viewership, and day 3 of the Pacific Showdown's VOD had over 40,000 views on Twitch last time I checked. So, obviously people are interested in it, and there is something there for them to do. It was nice to see these LAN events kind of be set up, because you don't have two casters from across the world color casting over the streams. You actually saw live interviews. People were sitting down there watching these events as they happened. They could hear the casters as it was going on. And then we got an analysis and a breakdown after with players, with team leaders, and we saw a lot of cool interviews come out of it as well. I kind of like that they are now providing content and providing media opportunities for these contenders' team, and that is huge because that is what will make them marketable. We already know that Element Mystic is marketable, and now we know that Clockwork Vendetta is extremely marketable just because they have this underdog kind of reputation about them. Not only did they make a new meta and become popular doing whatever they want, they also sent an Overwatch League contenders team all the way down into Open Division. They also proved that this isn't just Overwatch, but at a lower skill level. When you look at GOATs, it's the composition that every team seems to run, and it has become the meta of Season 2 of the Overwatch League. Most of you probably know this, but GOATs came from a now contenders team that went by the name of GOATs. They popularized the meta through their consistent wins and beefy composition that most contenders teams struggled to combat when it was first being used. The trend quickly spread across contenders and all of Overwatch, really, making it the go-to meta when Overwatch League started in February. See, the advantage that Contenders has over the Overwatch League is that their matches are generally lower stakes, and that's especially true at the beginning of the season. What this does is allows them to experiment with compositions at a high level of play without the pressure that the Overwatch League teams face to win. Contenders usually aren't afraid to try new compositions in hopes that they can take the enemy by surprise and cement a new meta in their wake. The new blood are eager to prove themselves, and it shows in their playstyles, especially with Bumper, a tank known for his aggressive style. Overwatch Contenders is refreshing, and the effort that the semi-professional teams put in shows through their explosive playstyles. As someone who watches a lot of Overwatch, I can understand how easy it is to get overwhelmed, but in the lulls between Overwatch League stages, make sure to check out a few Contenders matches when you can. The Atlantic and Pacific Showdown were amazing events, but I am so excited for the Gauntlet when we will see all of the playstyles from different regions clash. As always, my name is Malik. Let me know what you guys thought about the Overwatch Contenders event. Let me know what you're most excited for. Talk to you next time.